So I will give today a presentation about basic results in proof theory, and I will start with a historical overview. So I'm going back to the old Greeks. So there's Aristotle, and he started somehow to investigate logical mechanisms. And he is famous for introducing certain logical roots, which were called syllogisms. Also in the ancient Greek phase, there was Socrates, and he also is quite important for the development in logic, because he was really posing the question or the problem that some facts have to be proved. And so it's a famous result that there are infinitely many prime numbers. And what's most important here is not the result, but that somebody set up a formal proof for this. And then for a long time, not so much happened in the development of logic. And in the modern times, it started with Frege, who set up really a formal system for predicate logic. And this idea was to set up a logical foundation for the whole of mathematics. But we all know that this did not really work. So Frege formulated a work, Grundgesetze der Arithmetik, but when finally he finished his book, at the very end, there was a problem found, the so-called Russell antinomy. Namely, in modern terms, it's the fact that somehow the set of all sets which don't include themselves as an element is not a set at all. And this produced some sort of foundational crisis in the mathematics, namely what formations are allowed, what are not allowed. And this had some reaction. So some people just continued as before, but some other mathematicians took this very serious, and they put question marks on the underlying logic. So there was Brouwer, who said, well, we should restrict our logical formalism. And let's say, if we prove a disjunction, we should also be precise about what part of the disjunction we prove. And if you prove an existential statement, then we also should provide a witness. So Brouwer set up a formal system called intuitionism. And then there were also other people, Weil and Poincaré, and they were somehow setting up a system, well, you're only allowed to form sets on the basis of sets which you have constructed before. So they took the natural numbers for granted, and then they figured out what can we do when we build up the set theoretic universe in a predicative way. Hilbert himself said, well, we want to live in the world created by Cantor, and we don't want to have restrictions in our world. So he said, well, Cantor created a paradise, and we want to conserve this paradise. And so he set up sort of program. The program consisted of two parts. First of all, you should formalize the whole of mathematics. And afterwards, you should show that the system you created is not producing contradictions. And you should show the consistency by means which are completely finitary. And in reaction to this program, Kurt Gödel proved his famous incompleteness results, namely, first of all formal systems which are somehow reasonable are incomplete. So you cannot formalize the whole of mathematics. And moreover, even if you set up a simple system for arithmetic, like the piano arithmetic, you cannot prove the consistency of the formal system by methods which are in the theory pre-arithmetic itself. Pre-arithmetic does not prove the consistency of itself. Now, this was somehow a great problem for the original Hilbert program. Then later, Jensen came up and he gave a new interpretation of Gödel's results in the light of Gödel's program. So what he did is he showed pre-arithmetic can prove the transfer induction for every ordinal alpha when alpha is formalized in an appropriate way in the system of pre-arithmetic. So we need an arithmetization for alpha. And then pre-arithmetic is so strong that it can prove the transfer induction for all alpha less than epsilon zero, which is the least fixed point of the omega function, the least alphas, the least xi, that xi is equal to omega xi. Moreover, he showed one can show the consistency of pre-arithmetic by means of transfer induction up to epsilon zero. And the new point here is it suffices to have quantifier-free transfer induction. And you can do this proof in primitive recursive arithmetic, which is even a subsystem of pre-arithmetic. So he was able to condense the transfinite part of pre-arithmetic in one single schema, which is the quantifier transfinite induction. And later, this type of investigation has been pursued by Pfefferman and Schütte. And they gave an analysis of the predicative universe. They analyzed predicative analysis and they showed predicative analysis can be analyzed by using ordinals below a certain ordinal, which is called gamma zero. I will not explain this ordinal in this talk, but gamma zero is the limiting number for predicative analysis. And then the subject flourished. And nowadays, the main proponents of ordinal analysis are Michael Ratjen and Toshi Arai. And this is a flourishing subject, but I will not go into the modern developments. It's just for the general overview. There's another branch of proof theory, which is called proof mining. And this has been proposed by Kreisel some time ago. And nowadays, it's a group around Ulrich Kohlenbach, which is very successful in applying proof theory techniques to extract information out of given proofs. Another branch of applied proof theory has to do with concrete incompleteness. It concerns combinatorial assertions, which are true but not provable so in first order pre-arithmetic. And it started with Paris and Harrington. And nowadays, the strongest applications are provided by the work of Harvey Friedman. And Harvey Friedman has published on his webpage a whole book on concrete incompleteness emerging from Boolean relation theory. Now, let me explain in a minute what my subject was for many years. It was the subject of phase transitions. Phase transitions related to concrete incompleteness. So let me recall, what is a finite tree? A finite tree, T with a tree relation, is a poset such that there exists a root, an element in this set of nodes, which is minimal with respect to the tree ordering. So what does this mean? We have a structure like this. And this element here is then the root. Moreover, if you take an arbitrary node like this one, and you look at the nodes downwards, then this is a linear ordering. So for every node in T, the set of predecessors is linearly ordered. This gives a notion of a finite tree, which is also known as finite unstructured tree. It is known, it's easy to show, that for every finite tree, one has the property that for all nodes S and T in the tree, there exists an infimum. So what is the infimum? Well, take another node like this one. What is the infimum? The infimum will be the first meeting point. If you go to the root from the red node or from the blue node, there's a first point where those points meet. And this is the infimum. The least upper bound of the elements in which are both below the two points. Now, if you have the notion of infimum, we can define what an homomorphic embedding is. A tree T embeds homomorphically into tree T prime if and only if there exists a one-to-one mapping from T into T prime such that this embedding is preserves, such that this embedding preserves infima. So for all S and T in T, we take the infimum of S and T in the first tree and take H of it, then it moves, well, then H of this one is the infimum of the images, infimum of H of S and H of T. And then Friedman's assertion, Friedman's Kruskal theorem with regard to a bounding function F is the following true statement. And it's a complex statement. Now it reads as follows. Given any number k, we will find a huge number m so big such that for all finite sequences of finite trees, so for all sequences t0 to tm of finite trees, in case that this sequence is not too chaotic, so this means if for every I less than or equal to m, the number of nodes in Ti is bounded by k plus f of I. So f is the number theoretic function. And then one checks that the growth rate of the number of nodes is controlled by k and f. Then it happens that there exists numbers I and j less than or equal to m such that I is less than j and Ti embeds into Tj. And in general, these numbers will be very big. So of course, we assume that f is some interesting function, let's say the identity function. And Harvey Friedman was able to show the famous result that Peano-Smithic does not prove the Friedman's version of Kruskal theorem for the identity function. And that's a difficult result. And basically, what is needed to prove this is shown. We will show this in our talk today. Now, Friedman's result has been refined by Matuszek and Löbel. What Matuszek and Löbel did is they considered the following function. Instead of the identity function, they studied a log function. Fr of I is R times the binary log of I. So this grows slower than the identity function. And they showed if one has R is equal to 0.5, then Peano-Smithic does prove Friedman's version of Kruskal theorem. But if you have R equal to 4, then Peano-Smithic does not show Friedman's Kruskal theorem for F4. Now my contribution to this theorem was I write down this real number. C is 0.6395596. And this number is a recursive real number, but it's not known whether it's rational or not. Anyway, I was able to show two things. If R is less than or equal to C, then PA does prove Friedman's version of Kruskal theorem for FR. And if R is bigger than C, then if R is bigger than C, then PA does not prove Friedmann's Kruskal theorem for FR. So this number here is a critical number for Friedmann's theorem. And that's what I call phase transition. Okay, so much for the overview. And now I want to give a plan of my talk. So I will prove two results. I will cover the Gensen result, and I will cover the result on classifying provably recursive functions. Now, what's interesting here is, well, one should, of course, know the cut elimination result, but it's equally important not only to know the result, but also to understand how it is proved, because the technique is very versatile and can be used for all sorts of purposes. And once you have the cut elimination result, you find many applications. One is application about theorem by Herbron. We have applications to interpolation results. We have the subformula properties and many more. The second result, which I want to cover, is classification of the provably recursive functions of PA. And I will write down a scale, a class of functions, H alpha, alpha smaller than epsilon zero. And I will show that every provably recursive function is bounded by some function H alpha. This has the effect that, well, if every provably recursive function is bounded by some H alpha, then the function H epsilon zero itself is no longer be provably total in PA, because it then would be bounded by a function H alpha for some alpha smaller than epsilon zero. And the scale functions are set up in a way that if the index alpha is less than the index beta, that H alpha is eventually strictly dominated by H beta. So this is a Poiseuille 2 statement, which will be true, but not provably so in P-anosmetic. And once we have this result, there are numerous applications. Many natural results regarding concrete incompleteness follow from this. It's a result by Paris Harrington, Goodstein's independence result, the result on Hydra games, Friedmann's finite forms. So Friedmann's Kruskal theorem falls under this. And my phase transitions are also related to this. The technique is very general. And moreover, once one has understood the technique for P-anosmetic, can also be used for explaining the proof theory of stronger systems. So later, when one goes to stronger systems, to implicative systems, then one studies ordinal functions, and all what one has learned from P-anosmetic is good for extending and to show the, to analyze the stronger series. As I said, I want to give a proof of Gensen's result, and this will be some form of teaching presentation. So I will first cover what is Gensen calculus, and then I will go to the provably recursive functions. Now, when it's a sort of teaching presentation, I have to define what is the setup. So there are conventions, namely, first of all, I have to make clear what are the variables. And I choose a collection of free variables. It's a countable infinite set of free variables. And I have a countable infinite set of bound variables. The free variables are a1 to a2, and et cetera. And the bound variables are the xi. And this is somehow important, and I will explain when it becomes important. Well, actually, it's not that important, but it's very useful to have them. Then I assume I have a signature with function symbols and relation symbols and constants, but I assume that constants are subsumed under function symbols of LLT zero. And I can build terms with the use of the free variables. So every term only concerns free variables. These are the variables showing up over here. Once the terms are fixed, I write down what are the prime formulas. The prime formulas have the usual form. If P is a predicate relation symbol and T1 to Tn are terms, then this is an atomic formula. And the always false formula, the bottom, is also a prime formula. And using this, I built up composed formulas, and I use a very short fragment of predicate logic. I just built up formulas with implication and universal quantification. For example, the formation rule is if X is not yet bound in phi of A, then for all X, phi of X is a formula. Then I define certain abbreviations, namely all other formulas are defined in terms of my symbols. So I define what is the negation, I define what is the disjunction, I define what is the conjunction. And since I have a quantifier for universal quantification, I have all the quantifier for existential quantification. The next important thing is, what is a secant? A secant has a form gamma double dot delta. And this notion differs from author to author. So I'm working with finite sets of formulas. Sometimes it's also finite sequences of formulas, but this is not so important in our context. So gamma and delta are finite sets of L formulas. Now, what is the intended interpretation of a secant? Well, basically, one considers the elements from gamma as assumptions, and delta stands for what can be concluded. Now, delta is a finite set, and normally you want to have one conclusion, so one takes the disjunction over all elements in delta. So the idea is here, the sequence stands for there will be a proof tree in some sense, let's say natural deduction sense, with assumptions in gamma and conclusion, the disjunction over delta. Now, to set up the proof for the Gentzen result, one has to figure out what is the underlying proof system. The proof system is the Gentzen calculus. Now, what are the rules? The rules are, well, first we start with the axioms. So we have two sorts of axioms. One is this one. From gamma comma P, so this is a union of singleton P with gamma, I can conclude the disjunction over P and delta. Well, I have P as an assumption. Of course, I can draw the conclusion P. And this secant is considered as an axiom. But the internal justification is, well, from assumptions in gamma and P, I can derive the disjunction over P and the elements of delta. And the other one is the rule which is says, from a false formula, you can derive everything. So if you have assumptions gamma bottom, then you can derive delta. And we write down this as an axiom. So this secant here is an axiom. And this other secant is also an axiom for every prime formula P. Then we have rules, proof rules. Proof rules explain how one can go from one secant or from two secants to another secant. The first rule we consider is the implicational introduction in the succedent. So I want to derive phi implies psi in the secant. So it stands on the right hand side. So it's important. Here is the double dot. And this error implication succedent means the formula shows up on the right hand side of the double dot. Now, if you can, well, of course, if we know natural deduction, if you can derive from assumption phi conclusion C, then we can derive from phi the implication to psi. So the corresponding secant will be gamma comma phi on the left hand side in the antecedent and C delta in the succedent. Now the rule for implication introduction in the antecedent is the more difficult. And the reason is, well, the negation of an implication is written down here. The negation of phi plus psi is the conjunction of phi and not psi. And a formula in the antecedent basically corresponds to a negated formula. So I want to introduce the formula phi implies psi in the antecedent. The side formula is gamma delta. And for this, I need two sequences as premises. One is gamma comma psi double dot delta. And the other one is gamma, but now phi is showing up in the succedent. And this has to do with this interpretation. The other thing is, you can also read it in terms, assume that you have assumptions gamma phi implies psi double dot delta. Now, assume you have gamma and phi implies psi, how can you derive delta? Well, assume you have gamma and phi implies psi as assumptions. You look here, from gamma you can conclude phi and delta. So assume that you cannot derive the disjunction of a delta, but phi. And if phi and phi implies psi, then you can derive psi. And from assumptions, gamma and psi, you can conclude delta. So by all means, from what you have here, you can form a proof for the disjunction of delta. But that's not what's written down here. It is just stating if you have this sequence and this sequence, then you can derive this new sequence. What I gave was just an informal explanation of how the sequence works. Now for the other two rules, it's very similar. We have introduction of a universal quantifier and succedent. So from phi of A, I derive for all x phi of x if A satisfies the condition on variables. So there's no problem with A showing up in wrong places. A does not show up in the three variables of gamma, for all x, phi of x, and delta. Okay, and the other rule which I have is I can derive the universal formula in the succedent by assuming that I have derived phi of t in the premise. So from gamma phi of t double dot delta, I can derive gamma for all x double dot delta. This rule is basically very similar to an extension introduction. If I have derived non-phi of t, if I have derived phi of t, then I can derive there is an x phi of x. And if you read this in this formalism via the double negation, then it's basically the same. And we have the cut rule. If we have a formula psi showing up in the succedent and antecedent, then we can cut it off and we can derive gamma delta. And if you work in a context of a formal theory, we have more axioms, then we have the T rule. So if phi is an axiom, and if you can derive delta from gamma and phi, then we can derive delta already from gamma. But this only applies in the context of a rule, if you have a theory involved. Moreover, we are dealing with predicate logic with equality. We have a rule for the identity equations. So we can derive gamma delta if we have previously derived gamma comma t is equal to t double dot delta, because t is equal to t is very reasonable. Then we have this introduction rule for function symbols. We can derive this sequence from this sequence. How is this motivated? Well, assume that you have gamma and these equalities over here. If you have these equalities over here, then you have can derive this equality, and from this equality to this equality, you can derive delta. Of course, then you can derive delta from these assumptions. And we have a corresponding rule for the relation symbols. From this sequence, we can derive this sequence. So basically, if you have all these assumptions, you can derive this one, then you conclude delta, and then you have this thing. For preparing the cut elimination, we need a complexity measure for formulas. It's a formula rank. The rank of atomic formulas is zero. The rank of an implication is the maximum of the ranks of the subformulas plus one. And the rank of a quantified formula is one plus the complexity of the kernel. And then the important notion is I can derive a secant gamma delta with height bounded by n and all cut rings should be smaller than r. This is the definition of what is in this box here. This means there's a proof in this system with these axioms and rules of height less than or equal to n, where all cut formulas have complexity rank smaller than r. And what we are going to show is if we have a situation like this, then we can transform this r into zero with the cost that the n is going upwards. And this will be the cut elimination theorem. Now, how to prove this? We need some simple lemmas. The first lemma is tautology lemma. If you have an arbitrary formula phi, from phi you can conclude phi. And we can prove this by a proof which is as long as the rank of phi times 2. And that's an easy proof. It's by induction on the rank of phi. If phi is a prime formula, then this is already an axiom. But if it's not an axiom, one has to make up a proof. How to prove this? Well, as I said, we do induction on the rank of phi. And assume the last, assume phi, for example, is a form for all x psi of x. Then the induction hypothesis says by 2 times the rank of psi and 0, you can prove gamma psi of a double dot psi of a comma delta. Now we can prove this for all a, and we choose a so that a is not in the free variables of gamma delta and for all x psi of x. What we then do is we perform here to this formula an universal introduction in the antecedent. And then we use the corresponding rule on the right-hand side, namely universal introduction over this psi of a. And now we have to check that the variable a is fine, but this is the case. So we can derive with 2 times the rank of psi plus 2 and 0 gamma comma phi double dot phi comma delta. And this number here is 2 times the rank of phi. So we see the proof was quite easy. The next theorem is the substitution theorem. If you have derived a secant gamma double dot delta and assume gamma depends on a free variable b and delta also could depend on a free variable b, and B does not show up elsewhere. Now, you take an arbitrary term, no restriction on the term, and then you can substitute S for B in gamma and S for B in delta, and it doesn't change the complexities of the derivation. And the second theorem is a structural theorem. And if you have derived a secant, and if you can extend gamma to gamma prime and delta to delta prime, and this, you can extend delta to delta prime modulo the false formula, then from this assumption, you can derive the extended sequent. If you you can derive it with the same bounds here, but you can also are also allowed to make those numbers bigger. And so this basically means you can put additional stuff in your derivation and it will be stable under this. And what I want to do is I want to give a proof of the substitution theorem. Now, that's not fully obvious. So how can we do this? The proof is by induction on N. Now there are certain cases. If gamma B delta B is an axiom, then gamma S delta S is also an axiom. So there's nothing to do. The interesting and difficult part is the introduction of a universal quantifier on the right hand side. So assume we have derived N R gamma B double dot delta B, comma for all x psi of x and b is derived from a shorter derivation n0 and r gamma b double dot delta b psi a b comma, and now it depends on, there are two cases. One case is this formula did not show up in the premise, and the other case it is it did show up. So that's one peculiar property of the sequent calculus. It could be that the formula you are deriving is already present in the premise, and we just assume this. Now, how can we perform? And A fulfills here the variable condition for allowing the universal introduction. Now, what's the trick? The trick is now we apply the induction hypothesis. And you would think we apply the induction hypothesis to this B, but that's not the case. We apply the induction hypothesis first to A. That's the reason why I'm showing the proof. Induction hypothesis, you can derive with the same derivation length, gamma B delta B, psi, and now I replace A by a new variable C, B, for all x psi of xb. And the conclusion is C is fresh. C is fresh for the context. C is not showing up in the free variables of term S. Then the next step is I apply the induction hypothesis again and obtain now gamma S double dot delta S psi of C and S and the formula for all x psi of x and s. And now at this moment I can use the universal introduction. And now what is the point here? The point is that I took care about this C. C is now fresh for the context. C does not show up in the whole sequence over here. Because C is fresh, C is not in the free variables of S. And C, of course, is chosen in a way that it also does not show up elsewhere. And then I can conclude with N and R gamma S double dot delta S for all x psi of x and s. That's it. So the proof is basically simple, but the interesting point is here to apply the induction hypothesis twice. The same trick is needed in proving this theorem, because by extending formulas gamma to gamma prime or delta to delta prime, you have to be careful what is a nice variable for the original derivation is maybe not a nice variable for the system where you have the extended sequence. And so you need a renaming of the variable, but then everything is fine. Next theorem we are studying is the inversion theorem. And what does this mean? Basically, you can revert certain applications of roots. So here we have implication in the antecedent, and we can revert it backwards to its premises. Now, of course, we are not saying that this formula here has been derived last time. It could also be that derivation was making use of gamma and delta, and that means that we cannot reduce the n is contained, but basically from this formula here, from this sequence here, we can go back to this formula. Another inversion concerns the occurrence of an implication, the antecedent, and then we can invert to the two premises. And the third inversion is if we have a universal formula in the antecedent, then we can invert it to a witness, to an instantiation. So from Forlix phi of x, you can conclude phi of t. And now you ask, is there also an inversion for universal formulas on the in the antecedent? And the answer is no, that's not going to happen. Anyway, we prove assertion C. Well, how does this go? Well, induction on n. Well, if this here is an axiom, well, axioms are axioms due to prime formulas, then this is not responsible for making this sequence an axiom. So gamma delta will be an axiom, and then this is derivable since gamma delta is an axiom. Now we assume that in the critical case that for all x, phi of x has been derived. This means this formula is the principal formula of the last inference. So what do we have? Then there exists an n0 smaller than n, and here's some k, gamma double dot delta, for all x, phi of x, comma, phi of a. This is the premise of this conclusion. And now we have to be careful again, because the next step is we apply a substitution. And we replace our variable A by a fresh variable C. C is in particular a variable where term T doesn't show up. Then we apply induction hypothesis. So the n is n0. Induction hypothesis gives, we can derive gamma double dot delta. We invert this formula here, phi of t, and we have phi of c over here. Now we can apply substitution again. And we substitute for this variable here the term t. And since c is completely new, we can do so. And we arrive at the formula, the sequence which was desired. Okay. As I said, I wanted to prove the cut elimination theorem. Now we come to the heart of the matter. So everything up to now was very simple, but now comes the complicated technical part, and it's the preparation for the cut elimination result. So if we can derive a sequence gamma double dot delta from premises gamma comma phi delta and gamma double dot phi delta. Well, it looks like that we have applied a cut, but look for the side conditions. Assume that we can derive one sequence with height bounded by n, cut ranks are strictly smaller than r, and the other sequence by a proof of height bounded by m and all cut ranks strictly smaller than r. And now if the rank of phi less than equal to r, so it could be that the right rank of phi is equal to r, then I'm not allowed to do a cut. And still I can derive gamma delta with the same bound on the cuts. But now I have to pay a price, and the price is I have to go up with the derivation height. And for proving so, I have to set up some argument. So how does the proof go? Well, first of all, if the rank of phi is equal to zero, then do induction on M. But that's basically very easy, and I will skip that part. Now assume that the rank of phi is bigger than zero. And moreover, assume that phi is the principal formula. Of the last inference. If phi is not the principal formula, then I can apply induction hypothesis and everything is simple. But assume phi has been derived. Then there are two basic cases. The first case is phi is an implication, psi implies psi. Then what? So we do induction on n, and I write down what we have. So we derive this formula. And this is an implication, the antecedent. So we have two premises. Okay, these are the two premises, and to those ones, I can apply the induction hypothesis. I obtain with m plus two times n zero, r. Well, the induction hypothesis is I take this premise and this part here, and I can cut out this file. I can also apply induction hypothesis to this part. I take the file over here and cut it out with this file. But I want to arrive at this sequence here. But this sequence is different from this sequence. This sequence is different from this sequence. So I'm stuck. Now, in case that I'm stuck, I have to work on the other assumption. So I'm doing induction on this N. And when I'm stuck, I look at the other part. And to this part, I apply inversion. And inversion yields with M and R gamma. Well, phi is an implication. Phi is this formula. So I get this one. Aha, and now I have to zoom in. First of all, let us consider this sequence and this sequence. We see that the formula psi shows up two times. Here in the succedent, here in the antecedent. And we can perform a cut. The rank of psi is strictly smaller than R. Therefore, I can apply cut and obtain with M plus 2 times N0 plus 1. This is an upper bound of M and M plus 2 times N0 and R gamma double dot chi delta. Now I'm not yet done because still the he has to be eliminated. Now I'm looking up at this sequence over here and this sequence over here. We see we can try to cut out he. The rank of he is smaller than R. So by a cut, you can arrive at M plus, and now we have to take what? A strict upper bound of this number and this number. Now M plus 2 times N is bigger than this number, and M plus 2 times N is also bigger than this number, because N0 is smaller than N and N1 is smaller than N. So with M plus 2 times N and R, I get gamma double dot delta. And that is what I needed to show for this case. Now I treat the next case, namely, assume that phi is the form, so it's the second case. Phi is a form for all x psi of x. We did induction on N0, did induction on N, and the premise now we have is that I, well, this is the formula we have derived with N and R, gamma comma phi double dot delta. Phi is the universal formula. Universal formula is introduced in the antecedent. So I have my witnessing formula psi of t for some term t, formula phi shows up again in delta. And that's important in doing the cut elimination. The formula phi, which is derived, can already be present in the premise of the rule, in the antecedent. Now, this does not matter so much, so we can apply induction hypothesis. And we obtain with m plus 2 times n0 and r gamma, comma, psi of t, double dot delta. But we want to arrive at gamma double dot delta, but we are not yet there. This formula here is still, problematic. Now we have to remember what else do we have? We have the other premise was gamma double dot phi comma delta, and phi was the universal formula. We apply again inversion. An inversion gives gamma double dot gamma double dot psi of t double dot comma delta. Now we have to zoom in. We see this sequence and this sequence. The rank of psi of t is strictly smaller than r, since the rank of phi is less than equal to r. And therefore, we can apply cut to a formula of lower complexity and can derive with m plus 2 times n0 plus 1, but this is bounded by m plus 2n, r gamma double dot delta. And that is the proof of the reduction lemma. Now, once we have the reduction lemma, we have the cut elimination theorem. So if we can derive a sequent gamma double dot delta with height bounded by n, all cut rings are strictly smaller than r plus one, then I can derive the same sequent with height bounded by 3 to the n, and all cut rings are strictly smaller than r. The proof is as follows, is by induction on n. And the proof is straightforward. One looks what was the last premise, one applies induction hypothesis, and then one does this, then one applies the same rule again. There's only one exception, so the proof is simple. There's one case, critical case, is cut of complexity r. So assume you have shorter derivation of a sequent gamma comma phi double dot delta, and we have another shorter derivation of gamma double dot delta comma phi. And now the rank of phi is strictly smaller than r plus one. This means that the rank of phi is less than equal to r. Now with the reduction lemma, not the reduction lemma yet. First of all, we have to apply induction hypothesis. We obtain with 3 to the n0 and r gamma comma phi double dot delta, and with 3 to the n1 r gamma double dot delta comma phi. Now comes the reduction lemma, and the reduction lemma gives what? The reduction lemma gives with 3 to the n1 plus 3 to the n0 times 2 and r, the rank of phi, here is less than equal to r. Yeah, I can cut out the phi by the reduction lemma. and I get the secant gamma delta, which I want to have, where the cut bound is now R. And this number here is 3 to the n1 plus 3 to the n0 times 2 is less than or equal to 3 to the n. And we are done. So that is the fundamental result of Jensen, because finally, if you have a derivation of n r gamma double dot delta, then we find, well, with 3 to the n, we get r minus 1 gamma double dot delta. With 3 to the 3 to the n, r minus 2, I get gamma double dot delta. And by iteration, we find with the tower of threes of height r of m, 0 gamma double dot delta. So if there's a proof with cut, there will be finally a proof without cut, but of course a very long one. And that's the famous result by Jensen. Okay, that was part one. And we could make a short break here if you like, or I can continue with the part on the provably recursive functions. Well, I don't get a response. So I will just slowly continue with the second part. So in the first part, we proved more or less in full detail how to do cut elimination for predicate logic. Now I want to apply this technique to get results on the provably recursive functions of first order P-arithmetic. And for this, I will set up a formal system which extends P-arithmetic slightly. It's a formal system Z, and it's a conservative extension of P-arithmetic. And there's a certain reason for doing so, and I will explain it in a minute. So what's the point here? The formal system Z contains function symbols for all primitive recursive functions. And the reason for this is that bounded formulas are then can be reduced to equations. And okay, what are the axioms? The axioms are as usual, namely we have zero and successor. Successors are never zero. The successor function is 1 to 1. And then we have defining equations for all the primitive recursive functions. Now, usually for P-arithmetic, you have axioms for plus and times, and now I have a bit more axioms, namely for every primitive recursive function, we have a corresponding axiom. So the n-ary zero function evaluates to zero. The n-ary projection function evaluates to the corresponding argument. The composition function, so if I have f composed with g's of x, it's a composition of f with the g's. And then if I have a function symbol for primitive recursion based on previously defined functions g and h, I have the corresponding rules. If the first argument is zero, then I have the first function g of x. And if the first argument is the successor, then I do recursion in the previous argument y, and I plug this into values for the function h. These are the mathematical axioms, plus we have the following formula, following schema. For all function, for all formulas f in the language, I have the induction scheme if I have f of zero, and for all x, if f of x, then f of the successor of x, then we have for all x, f of x. That's our formal system. Now, what hierarchies I want to use is, the hierarchies are the Hardy functions. The Hardy function is defined by recursion on ordinals alpha less than epsilon zero. So epsilon zero is least xi such that xi is equal to omega to the xi. And all ordinals less than epsilon zero have a unique Cantor normal form built up in terms of zero, omega, plus in times. Okay, so what is the Hardy function? The Hardy function H0 is an identity function. H alpha plus 1 of n is, I assume that H alpha is defined, and apply H alpha to the successor of n. And if lambda is a limit, and they have a fundamental sequence, lambda n converging to lambda, then H lambda of n is, I take the diagonal sequence H lambda n applied to n plus 1. Now, of course, the choice of the fundamental sequence is not arbitrary, it's very specific. And I assume that if lambda is a limit, then the fundamental sequence of omega to the lambda times beta plus 1 is given by this expression, so by continuity. And since the fundamental sequence of omega to the gamma plus 1 is omega to the gamma times argument, I have this definition of fundamental sequence. And for technical reasons, I also set alpha plus 1 of x is equal to alpha, and 0 of x is 0. But this is not that important. Now, what is the goal? The goal of the second part of the talk is the following. If this formal system Z proves this assertion here, for all x is the y, and phi is, I wrote a quantifier free, I assume that phi is a prime formula. But this does not matter so much, because in the context of primitive recursive functions, every quantifier free formula is equivalent to a prime formula. Now, if phi, so phi could be the formula describing the Kleene predicate, so I can with phi codify, let's say, the ease program of a Turing machine. And so what is stated here, if Z proves the totality of an algorithm, if for all inputs X there exists a Y, phi XY, then I can say something about the growth rate of the Ys depending on X. So there exists one alpha less than epsilon zero such that for all inputs M, there exists an N bounded by H alpha of M, such that in standard structure, the formula phi holds true for M and N. So it's H alpha, which bounds the underlying probability total function. And I want to give a proof of this. Now, how can one do so? Well, the idea is I want to apply cut elimination. Cut elimination has a big advantage. Once you have a cut-free proof, you can trace back due to your derivations, and you can figure out what is contained in your premises. Now, the formal system Z does not allow cut elimination because you have this induction axiom, and then when you cut with those induction axioms, you have no control about your derivation. What one does is one moves from the finitary system Z to an infinitary system Z infinity, where one has cut elimination and where one can trace back derivations. The price one has to pay is from finitary derivations, one jumps to infinitary derivations. What makes the system infinitary? Well, it's the so-called omega rule. If you can derive phi of n for all numbers n, for all numerals n, then you can derive for all x phi of x, and this in a context. Now, what is the point? The point here is that with the omega rule, you can derive this sequence over here. Well, the question is, of course, why is this the case? Let us look. What do I want to prove? If I have phi of zero and for all x, phi of x implies phi of s of x, then I want to derive phi of n. And this for all n. And for this, I need a proof linear in n. So there will be number k plus 2 times n. And it will be cut-free derivation. And once I have derived this for all n, I can apply the omega rule for this phi of n to obtain for all x phi of x, and this proves the instance of induction. Now it's important to have seen this. So this is by induction, meter induction on n. So if n is equal to zero, then you have this situation. You have phi of zero in the antecedent. This formula here I call xi. And then we have phi of zero in the succedent. Well, actually this is a case of a tautology lemma, and by two times the rank of phi, one can prove this. So there will be some k for this. And that's it basically. Now assume for the induction step, we have already derived for some k, k plus two times n zero, phi zero, psi double dot phi of n. I want to replace this phi of n by phi of the successor of n. What I'm doing is I apply the tautology lemma again by k and zero. I get phi of s of n double dot phi of s of n. Aha. And what I can do in with these two derivations, I can apply the introduction of a universal, introduction of an implication in the antecedent. So with k plus two times n plus one and zero, I can derive phi of zero, comma, phi of n implies phi of s of n, double dot phi of s of n. And at this moment, and I have the formula psi somewhere. Put it over here. To this formula here, I apply universal introduction in the antecedent, and I obtain this k plus two times n plus two and zero, phi of zero for all x, phi of x and plus phi of successor of x, psi double dot phi of s of n. And now it turns out by magic, this formula is equal to psi. And so finally I got what I wanted. So what's the message here? By a proof, linear in n, I can derive this formula phi of n. And if I do the final omega rule, then I have an intrinsic proof of for all x phi of x. And note, there's no finite bound for all these numbers. So one is naturally led to introduce transfinite bounds over here. Okay, so we have proved induction. Once we have proved induction, we can basically perform our continuation procedure, because the other axioms are basically prime formulas. So that infinity will allow for cut-elimination. But this is not enough. We have to take care about existential witnesses. So what I do is I introduce a mechanism for controlling existential witnesses. And this is a function, a natural number, a number theoretic function f going from n to n. And f has two properties. F is weakly monotone, and f of m is at least as big as m. That's not a big deal. And these are my control functions. Moreover, I define f in square brackets m, and that's a new control function. And f in brackets m of I is f of the maximum of m and I, and that's it. So f in square brackets m is a bit quicker than f, but not much. What I also need is a term complexity function for ordinals alpha less than epsilon zero. It's basically every alpha less than epsilon zero is a unique term representation, and this term representation has a certain length. And the norm of alpha is a natural number, measuring the length of the term representation. So the norm of zero is zero, and the norm of omega to the alpha plus beta in Cantor normal form is, well, I take one plus the length of alpha plus the length of beta. So what is the goal with this norm function? Well, the norm function has a property: if alpha is less than beta, and the norm of alpha is less than equal to n, then I can conclude that h alpha of n is less than h beta of n. So the norm function allows to calculate the point from which onwards this h alpha is eventually dominated by h beta. It gives a constructive approach to this. Okay. Now, for defining this infinitary system, Z infinity, so I'm now defining what Z infinity is. Well, the first feature is that I'm deriving closed sets, closed sequence. So all variables disappear because I don't need variables any longer because I have my omega rule. And I can derive a sequence gamma delta, well, controlled by F, with height bounded by alpha, and all cut rings are strictly smaller than R, if the following holds. Now there are three important things. First of all, my control operator should control the complexity of the ordinal showing up over here. The technical device, which is needed later, and I will explain when it is needed. And moreover, when one of the following holds, namely gamma contains a false, well, we have closed formulas in the language of arithmetic, they can be evaluated. Closed formulas can be evaluated when they are prime formulas. And gamma contains a false prime formula. Then I can derive gamma double dot delta. That's the rule, x files a quad Hilbert from the false formula can derive everything. Or delta contains a true atomic formula. Both cases are considered as axioms. Or I have an implication in the antecedent, and I can derive the premises for introducing an error in the antecedent. So I've derived gamma double dot delta phi with a shorter derivation, and I've derived gamma comma psi, I can derive delta with a shorter derivation. But the control operator F is in both sides the same. That's a natural way of introducing introduction in the antecedent. In the succedent, it's the same. So I assume that an implication is in a delta, and I have derived the premises, namely from phi, I concluded psi, with a shorter derivation and control operator F. These are the routine cases. Now for the universal introduction of the antecedent, it's no longer routine. So I have here a witness, phi of k, so Forlix phi sits in gamma. I've derived gamma, comma, phi of k, double dot delta. And now I assume, that's very important, the existential witness is controlled by my control operator. That's a point where I have witness control. And for the rest, it's basically standard, I would say. So I have the same control operator. The derivation is shorter, alpha zero is smaller than alpha, and that's it. For the universal introduction in the succedent, I have the universal formula shows up in the right-hand side, and I can derive phi of I for all I. All these alpha I are smaller than alpha. And it's very important that I need not the control operator F, but I need the control operator F in brackets I to weaken the requirements on the control operator so that I can embed the formal system into the informal system. And for the cut, I have, as usual, if I have cut formula phi, and I have shorter derivations of the premises of cut, and I can apply a cut. And here it's important that the rank of the cut formula is of course strictly smaller than R. And that's the formal system. Then one can show what? The first lemma. The first lemma is basically a sort of trivial lemma. So we have here the structural lemma. If I can extend gamma delta to gamma prime delta prime, I make gamma bigger, delta bigger, alpha bigger, R bigger, F bigger. And if the number alpha prime is controlled by the strengthened operator, then I can conclude the new sequence gamma prime delta prime. That is what you would expect. The point is, if you derive a true prime formula in the antecedent, you can leave it away. The same happens if you have a false prime formula in the succedent, you can leave it away because you can never introduce it. So the reason why you introduce such a formula, such a sequence, is because you have introduced gamma delta. Then you have the inversion rules for the implication in the succedent, the implication in the antecedent, and we have the inversion rule for universal formula in the succedent. And this is most important. So if F controls a derivation of gamma double dot delta comma for all x phi, then F of I controls gamma delta phi of I. And I will only prove the last one. So I will give a proof of F. What we are going to prove is if F proves with alpha and R gamma double dot delta comma for all x phi of x, then for all I with alpha R, then F of I controls the derivation for alpha R gamma double dot delta phi of I. And proof is of course by induction on the length of the proof. If this here is an axiom, then it's not the case that because of for all x phi of x. If this is an axiom, then gamma delta is an axiom, and then we are done. So assume for the critical case, assume that for x phi of x is the principal formula. Now, what is then the premise? Well, we have F of J proves with alpha J and R gamma double dot delta comma for all x phi of x comma phi of J. Be careful here. The formula for all x phi of x could be part of the premise. Now we apply induction hypothesis and we invert this universal formula to I. So we have these premises for all J. The induction hypothesis gives F J of I is alpha J and R gamma double dot delta comma phi of I comma phi of J. Now, of course, we consider the case J equal to I. Then these two formulas are the same. That is what we are hunting for. We can make alpha J bigger, that's fine. And then note F I in brackets I is the same as F in brackets I. So this operator works idempotently on the brackets. And that's important because otherwise this would make the proof very complicated. So if there would be too much growth involved, this would be the case where the induction would break down. But it's not going to happen. We have this nice property. And so then we can derive this f of I and alpha r, you can then gamma delta comma phi of I. So that's nice. Now the question is, why are we hunting for this type of proof system? And the reason is the following. Here we see why these cut-free proofs are so important. If you can derive an exponential formula as x phi of x with a cut-free proof and control operator f, then there's a k less than or equal to f of zero such that in n we have phi of k. Moreover, if f controls by a two statement, then f has a property that for all inputs m, there's an n bounded by the control operator such that phi of m and n is true. So that explains the motivation why we have the bounding operator f for our derivations. From f, we can read off existential witnesses and provably recursive functions. Proof of A. Now assume we have f derives this alpha and zero. There exists an x phi of x. Now, what is the existence x phi of x? It's not for all x not phi of x. What does this mean? This is for all x, phi of x implies falsity, implies falsity. So look, this is a bit complicated, but anyway, so from this, we can conclude the following. Namely, we can do inversion. We can invert this formula here. This is an implication. And of course, the left-hand side of the antecedent, so here is the empty set. But I don't mention the empty set, I just leave it away. Then we obtain with alpha and zero for all x, phi of x implies falsity, double dot falsity. On this, we perform induction on alpha. Now I need more space. So what do we have? We have f derives as alpha and zero. For all x, phi of x implies falsity, double dot falsity. Now look, what was the last inference here? Well, this cannot be introduced. It could only be that this has been introduced. So the last case is, the last rule was an inversion introduction's antecedent. So we find and k less than equal to f of zero, such that with f and the smaller derivation alpha zero and zero, we can derive for all x, phi of x implies falsity, comma, phi of k implies falsity, double dot falsity. Case one is we have in n that is true that phi of k holds. And then we are fine because this k is less than or equal to f of zero. And we are done. Case two is not the case. What can we do then? Well, then we have to zoom in into this situation here. That's an implication in the antecedent. Now by inversion, can derive as f alpha zero and zero. For all x, phi x implies falsity. Double dot And this formula phi of k whence goes to the succedent. But phi of k is a false atomic formula. By inversion of false atomic formulas in the succedent, we can conclude with alpha 0 and 0 for all x, phi of x implies falsity, we can arrive for falsity. And then we have the situation, this one here is the same as this one over here. The difference is we have arrived at the same situation, but with a shorter proof. Now the induction hypothesis says at this moment, there will be a k less than equal to f of zero, such that in the standard structure, phi of k is true. Aha, this was a nice proof. And now the second one is an application of the first one. Let's look. So we have f controls a derivation of for all x there exists y, phi of xy. Then by inversion, we get f of I controls with alpha zero. There's y, phi of xm. So we invert to m. And then we have there exists an n less than equal to f. We have this I is equal to m. There exists an n less than equal to fm brackets applied to zero. Such that in n we have phi of m and n. And this number here is equal to f of m. And that's it. So here we made use of inversion. And here I made use of A. And so the proof of B is a simple application of A. Then the next step is, so we now understand why the control operators control provably recursive functions. The next step is what is called embedding. From the finitary system, you can transfer derivations into the infinitary system. So if Z derives the secant gamma A delta A, then there exists finite numbers K and R and a primitive recursive control operator such that the control operator F, well, for the A's, we have to substitute numbers. So we have gamma M and delta M. So gamma A and delta A and the formal system with free variables. And in the informal system, infinitary system, we have to replace variables by numbers. So there exists numbers K, R, and primitive recursive function F, such that for all sequences of numbers m, f of m controls with omega plus k and r, the sequent gamma m double dot delta m. And the important part here is the embedding of the induction axiom. And for the induction axiom, it's the only place where one needs a transfinite derivation height. Now, once we have embedded formal derivations into informal and infinitary derivations, we have to study the effect of cut elimination to bounding operators. So once we have bounding operators like this one here, controlling the existential witnesses, we have to check what is going to happen with the control operators during the elimination of cuts. So we don't want to lose the information which we want to have finally. And that's a point where the reduction lemma comes in the game. And we know already the reduction lemma. We want to derive gamma double dot delta from premises gamma comma phi and gamma double dot delta phi and assume the rank of phi is bounded by R. Now the new thing is we have control operators G for this derivation and F for the other derivation. Now the question is what is the effect on the applying the reduction lemma. And the point is, what is needed is the composition of F with G. The composition of F with G is the composition of F with G plus some extra stuff, but that's not important. The moment most important is the composition of F and G, and I need F plus G to control the complexity of the ordinals involved here, but that's a technical thing, which is not that important yet. And proof. Well, the proof is nice, and I will give it. So the proof is by induction on what? Induction on I have to check. Will be induction on beta, yeah. Okay, induction on beta. And I will go directly to the critical case. And that is phi is a universal formula for all x psi of x. And it has been the principal formula. Now, what does this mean? So this means I have a shorter derivation, beta zero r, gamma, comma, phi is the universal formula, and I have a witness, psi of k, double dot delta. What I'm now doing is, first I get rid of phi using the induction hypothesis. So I have this formula here, and I have this part here, and I can cut out the phi. Induction hypothesis is with the composition of F and G, I can derive with alpha plus beta zero times two and R, gamma comma psi of K double dot delta. That's fine. Now I have to get rid of the psi of k, and there's no obvious way to do it, but we know we have here this part. And phi is this universal formula, which can be inverted to psi of k. So by inversion, I obtain f of k derives with alpha and r, gamma, double dot delta, comma, psi of k. And then the rank of psi of k is smaller than r, because the rank of phi is less than equal to r. So by a cut, you can derive with alpha plus beta times two r gamma double dot delta. But wait a minute. For applying a cut, I need an upper bound for those two derivation control operators. So I want to apply here CFG, but we are basically stuck. Because here's a k. Oops. And the k is an alien. There's no way to get the k under control. So the proof breaks down. That's very bad. And now the magic is the following, namely, we have introduced here this formula by applying universal introduction in the antecedent. And for this one, I have the additional information that K is bounded by G of zero. And that is going to help us because F of K, the operator, is bounded by F of G of zero. This is bounded by the composition of F with G. This is bounded by CFG. So this is a crucial point here. It's this information here, which helps us in an unexpected way to give us a bound for this F of K. And the K comes from the inversion. So it's by good luck that this K can be dominated by G0. And this explains how the composition comes into play in the cut-elimination result. Okay, and the next one is we want to prove the cut elimination theorem. So if you have derived gamma delta with cut ranks bounded by R plus one, I want to derive gamma delta with cut ranks strictly bounded by R. Now alpha goes to omega to the alpha, that's fine. Three to the alpha would suffice. But now the point is what is going on with F? I have to transform F into a new one. Now assume that in this proof, I have many cuts. If I want to get rid of the cuts and I want to, if this is under control, I have to apply the reduction lemma very often. Let's assume that here in this derivation to transform it, I have to apply the reduction lemma alpha many times. This means then I have to compose F alpha many times with itself. And that's the point here. From F, I go over to F alpha, and F alpha is the formalization of iterating F alpha many times. And how this is formalized? The iterate of F, F alpha of X is, here I have the maximum taken over, here take F of X plus one, it's just making F one bigger. And here I use the composition of F gamma and F delta. The gamma and delta are smaller than alpha. And I do this composition operators applied to X. Wait a minute, here there could be infinitely many gamma and delta smaller than alpha. So this maximum is not yet well defined, but the essential second point here is that I assume that the norm of gamma and the norm of delta are under control by F of X. And this means there are only finitely many gamma and delta which are involved. So this is a finite set of iterations which I take into the consideration. And then I can take the maximum of here. And this is going to work. If F proves, if F controls the derivation of gamma delta with alpha and R plus one, then F of alpha controls the derivation with omega to the alpha R and gamma delta. Proof, induction on alpha. A critical case is last case was a cut. Then I have the situation with F alpha zero, R plus one, gamma comma phi double dot delta, and F controls with alpha one, R plus one, gamma double dot delta comma phi. I apply induction hypothesis with F alpha zero, omega to the alpha zero R, gamma comma phi double dot delta. And here I get F alpha one, omega to the alpha one R, gamma double dot delta comma phi. Then comes the reduction lemma. So with composition of F alpha zero and F alpha one, I can derive what? Omega to the alpha zero plus omega to the alpha one times two R gamma double dot delta. Voila, and here I am. And now we look, this term here is bounded by f of alpha, because I zoom in here and here, and the norm of alpha I is less than or equal to f of zero. That's the moment where I need that the derivation heights are also in term complexity bounded by my outer bounding operator. And therefore I can draw this conclusion here. And then f alpha controls with omega to the alpha and r the derivation of gamma and delta. And that's it. Now, what's the point here? The point is as follows. If that, the formal system Z, proves a universal existential statement, and this for the formula phi, which is prime, then there exist numbers k and r and the prime primitive recursive operator f, such that for all m, there exists an n bounded by, and now I have to iterate my reduction theorem many, many times. I get a complex operator iteration applied to m, and then I have here the bound phi of the bounds for n in terms of m. Well, proof, let's have a look. How does it go? From the finitary derivation of this formula for all x, there exists a y, phi xy, with empty antecedent, I find there exist numbers k, r, and there exists a control operator f, primitive recursive, such that with f, omega plus k, and r, I can prove for all x, there exists a y, phi of xy. Then I do my first application of cut elimination. So with omega plus k iterates of f, I can prove with omega to the omega plus k r minus 1, for all x there exists y, phi of xy. Then I do another application of cut elimination. So I obtain for this operator a new iteration. The f omega plus k is iterated omega to the omega plus k many times. And here I obtain omega to the omega to the omega plus k r minus 2. For all x, there exists the y, phi of xy. So at the end, I obtain an f omega plus k, omega to the omega plus k, blah, 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 a long tower of omegas, here an ordinal, a long tower of omegas, one higher. Here's a zero. For all x, there exists y, phi of xy. Call this operator g. And then we apply our asymmetric interpretation of this assertion. And then we have for all m, there exists n bounded by g of m, such as in the standard model, we have phi of m and n. And that's basically the result which I wanted to show today. Finally, one has to compare these functions with the Hardy functions. That's possible. And the critical lemma is this one. If f is controlled by the alphas branch of the Hardy function, then f beta is controlled by basically h omega to the alpha plus beta and some other stuff. And by using this lemma iteratively, one can bound these functional iterations by one fixed h alpha. So I will not give a proof yet of this one because I'm running out of time. But the upshot is if Z proves for all x, there exists y, phi xy, phi is a prime formula. Then there exists an alpha less than epsilon zero, such that for all m, there exists an n less than equal to h alpha of m, such that in the standard model phi of m and n is true. And the corollary is that Peano's metric does not prove the totality of the Hardy function of level epsilon zero itself. And the fundamental sequence for epsilon zero of x is an omega tau of height x. And this one is a first combinatorial independent statement, which is independent of Peano's metric. So it's an instance of Gödel incompleteness. But one can also reformulate this in terms of Hydra games. And one can associate this with the Goodstein sequences with the Peres Harrington result. And so this is a basic result for proving independence results for pi to the two statements. And this assertion here, just in function of x and y, can be written as a primitive recursive predicate, so as the prime formula in our system. Yeah, and that's is all what I wanted to show today. So yeah, I will stop my presentation.